April 4th, 1968. An assassin's bullet silences a great civil rights leader. What begins is an intensive manhunt, an investigation that extends beyond North America into Europe. Meanwhile, an assassin with forged papers manages to elude the FBI. This true story has all the earmarks of a taut thriller, and it forms the basis of an American Experience documentary called Roads to Memphis. Tonight, we talk to the author of the book from which that film is based. This is A Conversation with Hampton Sides. Shortly after the assassination of Martin Luther King, one civil rights leader boiled everything down to one question. How could a 10-cent nobody like James Earl Ray kill a million-dollar leader like Martin Luther King? Well, in the book Hellhound on His Trail, Hampton Sides attempts to answer that question, and we are pleased to have its author here.
Great to be here.
Hampton, first off, it's not a direct connection, but there is something of a connection to the historical events. Your father was working for a law firm at the time of the assassination.
Right, yeah. I mean, you know, I think all writers want to go back to the place where they came from. I grew up here in Memphis. My father worked for Birch, Porter & Johnson, the law firm. Lucius Birch represented Martin Luther King when he came on behalf of the garbage workers. So I got an earful from my dad. I remember not, of course, the nuances of what was going on. I was only 6 years old, so I don't remember a whole lot of really what was going on, but I remember the fear in his voice when he came home from work. I remember it was the first time I ever saw tanks rolling down a street. The first time I ever saw guardsmen with fixed bayonets, and you know, just that feeling that I think all of us had, that our city was ripping apart, and that even before the assassination, and then when the assassination actually happened, fear of race riots and just that the city was just coming apart at the seams.
But you follow Ray and show him in prison, where he spends most of his adult life. Who was James Earl Ray? What kind of man was he? Where did he come from? Mm-hmm. And how did that place shape him as a man?
Who is James Earl Ray? That is the question. I mean, this is a guy with a very incoherent identity. You know, he's constantly changing his name. He's constantly moving around the country when he's not in prison. And no one can figure him out. He's literally trying to create an identity that is forgettable. He said, I want to have a face that no one will remember. He's changing his name. He's changing his face. He literally gets a nose job just before the assassination. He comes from rural Illinois. He was born in Alton, Illinois, and lived in a series of towns along the Mississippi River Valley, both in Missouri and in Illinois. He comes from a very, very poor family of felons and a very dysfunctional family. One very telling thing is that his father changed the family name repeatedly throughout Ray's upbringing. So these kids grew up not really knowing what their last name is.
You say in the book that he failed first grade. What did his teachers think of him at the time?
Well, I mean, you know, they took pity on him in a lot of ways. It was clear that he was coming from a very poor background, and he was a little bit of a troublemaker, not an idiot. Now, this is one of the things about Ray. Everyone says he's an idiot, and he's too stupid to pull off this crime. Well, no. He had above average intelligence. He was a voracious reader. He escaped from two maximum security prisons. This was a guy who had a certain kind of cunning, a certain kind of craftiness, a certain kind of intelligence.
I think it's right that you say that there is a chance that we could underestimate him. A 10-cent nobody really doesn't begin to get it, you know, when you stop and consider that when he's at Jeff City, he masterminds an escape. This was a pretty cunning escape, the way he planned it.
Yeah, he curled himself into a bread box. He worked in the prison bakery, and a false bottom was put on top of him, and more loaves were put on top of him, and obviously he had some help getting out of prison. He couldn't have done this without an accomplice. But he got on this truck that was bound for the honor farm, where you know some of the better criminals were actually working out on a farm. And he jumped out of this box and jumped out of the truck and ran down the railroad tracks into history. So, but he also, you, many of us may remember, he also escaped from Brushy Mountain in East Tennessee after the assassination, and initiated another big manhunt that finally led to his capture by bloodhounds in the mountains of East Tennessee.
He joins a white supremacist group in Missouri State Penitentiary, and at the time there is a rumor floating around that there is a bounty on Martin Luther King's head. Were you ever able to track down the source of that?
No. There were more than one. There was numerous sources. There were numerous bounties on King's head. The KKK, and there was a gentleman out of St. Louis named John Sutherland who offered $50,000 to kill Martin Luther King. Mm-hmm. In prison and outside of prison, he could very easily have come across these bounties, and I believe that the most likely scenario was the Sutherland bounty in St. Louis was the one that he wanted to connect to. Whether he actually connected to it is a very good question. Near the end of his fugitive travels in London, he robs a bank, he robs a jewelry store. He wouldn't be doing these things if he had been paid a lot of money. He was clearly desperate for money. So I believe that maybe he hoped to connect to one of these bounties, but that he never was able to connect the dots.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, one of the things that I know irritates historians is this thing about the conspiracy that keeps popping up.
Sure.
And you touched on it a little bit when you were talking about why would a guy who's, you know, need to rob a bank in England. But when he gets out of Jeff City and escapes, he goes down to Mexico. He's consorting with prostitutes. He buys a Mustang. He ends up staying in a hotel in Los Angeles. He goes to bartender school, takes dance lessons. You can almost see where people begin to think to themselves, where is he getting all this money?
I'm asking the same question. I mean, it's central to the whole story of Ray. Where did he get the money? And it's, I wasn't able absolutely to answer the question. And, of course, that fuels conspiracies. He himself said that he was involved in smuggling schemes and, small heists and robberies. He had a long history of robbing liquor stores and grocery stores. And, you know, so I believe it's quite plausible that he pulled off a number of heists along the way. The fact that we don't know the source of money doesn't necessarily prove that there's a conspiracy. It just is an unanswered question, and it's for me a very big one. And I'd be stupid to try to tell you that I understood all the sources of his money. I don't.
Mm-hmm. Do you tend to lean toward the fact that the idea that there was no conspiracy there?
I believe there was a conspiracy. I believe that it was a small and crude one. I think he had help along the way. I think it's very clear that he had help gathering aliases when he was in Toronto. There are various points during his year on the lam that are just big question marks, like mm-hmm. what was he doing in New Orleans? And, you know, why was he taking, you know, he was taking a locksmithing class and he was taking these dancing lessons and graduated from bartending school. Not clear why he was doing all these things. And, mm-hmm. you know, I believe that there ultimately was a small conspiracy, perhaps involving some of his family members or other kind of criminal lowlives that he associated with. but when we hear conspiracy, I think the common idea is that it's a giant, well-oiled, sophisticated, well-funded conspiracy involving the FBI or the CIA or the Mafia or the White House or, you know, all these different groups working in tandem. And, you know, I just don't think conspiracies work that way. Mm-hmm. I don't think that all those institutions and all those people could keep a secret for 42 years. If it was that well-oiled, they would have killed Ray early on to keep him from talking. And, you know, I'm just, I don't want to sound unpatriotic, but I just don't believe my government could pull off something that sophisticated. And it's just sort of boggles the mind that, you know, that all these institutions would somehow find miraculously a way to cooperate
right.
on
Too
something
many moving
like this.
Parts there,
Too many moving parts.
Right, yeah. But you did bring up Toronto. And that's particularly stunning because what we see in Toronto is we see that After Ray escapes Memphis, he's able to put together a birth certificate under a false name. What was that name again that he used?
Well, he used Paul Bridgman, and then he used Ramon George Snade. Uh-huh. And the thing about Toronto is, yeah, I think he had some help gathering those aliases, but the other side of it is Canada in the 1960s, it was just ridiculous how little information you needed to get an identity and to get a passport. You basically had to say you were who you said you were. That was all you needed. You didn't need a reference, you didn't need an address, you didn't need anything. The Canadian laws on this have changed since the Ray case, in direct response to the Ray case. But, you know, he went in there and basically he asked for a birth certificate. He said he had lost it. He got a new birth certificate. From the birth certificate, he could get a passport. He was on his way to London.
You were able to track the movements of Ray very, very well. But at the same time, in one of my favorite passages in the book, you likened him to a squid. You try to give us an insight of what it would be like to have a conversation with with Ray.
Yeah.
Describe to me a little bit about that passage.
Well, people who had conversations with him were always confused by what he was saying, what was true, what was not true. As if he's a squid who's like throwing up this big cloud of obscuring ink, and you know, you're trying to poke around. Is he in there? Is he gone? Was that a lie? What part of that was true? What was, you know, because he's always changing his story, just as he's changing his identity, just as he's changing his location. That was kind of his self-defense mechanism. That's the way he always operated. He mumbled a lot, so you couldn't understand what he was saying even when he said it. If you watch the House Select Committee on Assassinations testimony that he gave, you can just see the expression on the people who are interrogating him change. They start poking around, they think they've got something, and then they just, what did you say? What are you saying? What was that? Say that again? And he would change it, he would change the story, he would make something up, and then finally the color would all wash out of their faces. They would just give up. They just couldn't pursue this thing to any kind of satisfaction. That's the way he operated his whole life. And you know, it was like anyone who gets involved in this story kind of gets sucked into this big game that Ray was constantly playing with everyone, whether it was prison shrinks, doctors, lawyers, cops. It was just kind of, here I am, I'm gone, you try to figure me out, you know, kind of a taking a great pleasure in baffling people.
Yes, speaking of the game, it even filtered into the way he used aliases. Eric Starvo Galt. It sounds suspiciously like Ernest Stavro Blofeld from the James Bond novels.
Yeah. Well, the alias that he was able to get was Eric Saint Galt. He didn't know what the saint stood for, so he pulled that one out of the hat, Starvo, although I think he transposed some letters. He was a reader of detective novels. He liked James Bond. That's probably where that came from.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's very odd. Now, let's switch over to Martin Luther King for a second. Now, Andrew Young pointed out that there wasn't a week that went by that since Martin Luther King was 25 years old that he didn't get a death threat.
Right.
How was King able to deal with that?
The courage that he had to go forward with his movement in the face of those threats is staggering. I mean, you know, just I don't know how he was able to do that. I don't know how he was able to do it without any sort of police detail, without having any kind of bodyguards. He had bodyguards in a sense, but they weren't armed. Mm-hmm. He believed that sent out all the wrong signals. He was an adherent of Gandhi's principles. He believed that if anyone had a nightstick or a gun or was armed, that it would project all the wrong signals.
But he had a few close calls there.
He did, and you know, he was stabbed in Harlem at a book signing. He had bricks and rocks thrown at him. His house was firebombed. As you said, he got these threats all the time. You ask how he dealt with it. I think the other part of it was a kind of resignation that the end could be any day now. It could happen today or tomorrow. I think in those last few months of his life in the spring of 1968, I think he felt the end was very near. And of course, we all know the speech that he gave the night before he died, in which he really seemed to prefigure his own death. Mm-hmm. He'd been given those kinds of speeches for weeks, but it kind of all crescendoed that night in that amazing speech. And he talked about sick white brothers, that there's a threats out there coming mm-hmm. from our sick white brothers. And in that sense, I think he kind of anticipated James Earl Ray, because if there was ever a sick white brother, it was Ray. So, yeah, but I think he was always kind of looking over his shoulder, expecting something to happen.
Yeah, and in 1963, he's watching television, and he says to Coretta Scott, that's exactly what's going to happen to me.
Yeah, he was watching the news of the Kennedy assassination, and Coretta did not contradict him. She didn't try to say, oh, honey, you know, that's not going to happen. She just sat there in silence with him, almost as if, you know, yeah, we know this is very likely. What's going to happen in the end?
You know, you talk about living with the danger, and there is a passage in the book about Ramsey Clark, the Attorney General
right.
under Lyndon Johnson,
right.
who was particularly worried about the threats on Martin Luther King's life during a particular march,
mm-hmm.
and he goes to a tent, I think, and finds
right.
King at that point, and.
Sleeping like a baby, you know. He King found a way to tune out all this stress and all these threats, and enjoy himself. I think once he kind of got past that initial shock, you know, when he came on the world stage and realized that he was going to be the subject of all this hate, he found a way to kind of live his life the way he wanted to live it, and tune out this turmoil that was kind of surrounding him.
Famous feud between J. Edgar Hoover and MLK. J. Edgar didn't make any bones about the way he felt about Martin Luther King in public, particularly when Martin Luther King wins the Nobel Peace Prize.
Yes, of course that could be a whole book unto itself. The story of Hoover's hatred of King. There's no doubt about it. He hated King. He thought he was a communist. He was shocked and at the same time somewhat titillated by stories of King's indiscretions. He thought King was a subversive. He thought that King's nonviolence thing was just an act, that because he said that violence always sort of followed King in a lot of these marches. And I think, you know, he just was probably a racist. And his vision of America was very different from King's vision. And that, of course, is one of the abiding sources of conspiracy, is that, well, this guy clearly hated King. He'd been hounding him for years. He'd sent his agents out to eavesdrop and bug and smear and sabotage King's movement. Why wouldn't he just take it a step further and have him assassinated? So, of course, that's one of the sources of the conspiracy theories. But I found that, you know, it's also one of the great ironies that this agency that had done so much to ruin King was the very agency that was commissioned with the responsibility of finding King's killer. And that once that started, these guys in the FBI, who had been hounding King and trying to ruin his life, started doing their job and started doing a very good job. I mean, the amount of shoe leather that was involved in finding Ray, the thousands of agents and the thousands of leads, most of them false leads, the sheer desperation that you can see in the memos coming out of Washington.
But Hoover understood the political responsibility of that too.
Yeah, and he also probably feared that people are going to say he did it. You know, that they think that he was involved.
Although one of the first conversations that occurred was with Hoover saying to, I think he was talking to somebody inside the FBI,
yeah.
but he said, we're not going to take responsibility for this investigation.
Yeah.
The first thing that we're going to do is we're going to let the Memphis Police Department take responsibility
yep.
for it.
He really didn't want to take it at first, and I'm not sure why, but it was something that he was loath to get into until Ramsey Clark finally said, no, we're doing it. Justice Department is you know, nominally, it was Hoover's boss. No one was actually Hoover's boss, I don't think. But
and,
Ramsey
and
Clark,
Hoover didn't particularly like Ramsey Clark.
No,
either.
No. Yeah. That's the other thing about this manhunt that was kind of interesting was just how dysfunctional it was. It was essentially J. Edgar Hoover, who hates the guy, the deceased, is running the FBI, but his boss is this younger liberal guy who loved King and greatly admired him, Ramsey Clark. These two guys can't even talk to each other. They hate each other so much.
Well,
so there's
Ramsey used to sit in Hoover's office when he was a kid.
Right, because his father had been in the Justice Department and was ultimately a Supreme Court justice.
So I guess he couldn't get that kid out of his mind.
Yeah,
what's this kid doing walking around being my boss?
And in the middle of the whole thing is this gentleman, Carthage Deloach, who's himself a real piece of work, but he's trying to kind of be a liaison between Hoover on the one hand and Ramsey Clark on the other, and then also LBJ in the White House. He's kind of running this manhunt, trying to make everybody behave and, you know, so they can go ahead with this thing and find the killer.
Mm. It's an amazing story when you get behind the scenes and find out some of the personality. The FBI, it has to be said, made some ridiculous connections between Martin Luther King and his supposed ties to communism.
Mm-hmm.
One in particular that struck me was when King was at a book signing and he was stabbed by this woman,
mm-hmm.
who was psychotic, I believe, and there was someone on his staff who was who had briefly flirted with communism, and he gave King a blood transfusion. Now from that, the FBI began circulating the rumor that there was communist blood running through
King's veins.
Right.
Yes. Yeah, this is the kind of, you know, they would, the kind of thing they would stoop to. I mean, you know, it was really unbelievable. You know, there's proof positive. There's commie blood running in King's veins.
But the worst was the package,
Right. Yeah. Someone within the FBI. Most accounts say it was this agent named Sullivan. Sent a package that was opened actually by Coretta Scott King that was kind of a greatest hits tapes supposedly of King's indiscretions from various bugging devices that had been placed in various hotel rooms over the years. It was pretty garbled and muddy. You couldn't really tell what it was. Occasionally it sounded like King in some sort of a sexual abandon or whatever, but it really was kind of hard to hear. But with this tape, there was a note that was written and addressed to King that basically said, you have one path here. There's only one way out for you. Essentially saying, commit suicide or you will be exposed as an adulterer. So, you know, this is the kind of thing, the level of sort of extortion that the FBI was stooping to. It didn't really have the desired effect. The tape was so murky, muddy, you couldn't really understand what was happening. And King decided that, you know, that, wow, this guy Hoover really is after me.
You seem to suggest that Hoover's obsession with King could have conceivably bolstered somebody like Ray.
There were people like Hoover and like Wallace and like the John Birchers and a lot of other groups that were kind of putting out this vibe into the zeitgeist, that King's a bad guy. This guy's a communist. He's subversive. He's unpatriotic. You know, when people like that put that poison out into the world, someone like Ray, who is a lost soul but is also quite ambitious, and who is a racist, takes that signal, I think, and is able to sort of begin to see how history would smile on his crime. In that sense, I believe that's a conspiracy as well, almost like the culture was implicit in this crime.
At one point in Los Angeles, Ray and King are only a few miles apart from each other. And that is one of the most important parts of the story because it starts something in Ray.
He must have said something that set Ray off because on March 18th, he checked out of his cheap hotel where he was staying with no notice and said he was moving. to Atlanta, Georgia. He put in a kind of an order for a change of address form, general delivery, Atlanta, Georgia. Mm-hmm. He didn't have any connection to Atlanta. As far as we know, he'd never been there. He had no friends there. But here he was moving to Martin Luther King's hometown. And so, and that's what he does. So it's a very odd set of circumstances. Hmm.
And then later in the conspiracy theories, people begin to talk about, or Ray himself, I think, and this may go back to what you were saying about the squid putting the ink out there and obscuring everything, that there was this person, Raul, that started to pop up somewhere in the trip. Mm-hmm. In fact, he claimed that Raul was the one who bought the gun in Birmingham, I believe.
No. He said that Raul directed him to.
Oh, I see.
Now, the thing about Raul is he never talked about Raul until after, well after the assassination, well after he was caught. He said that Raul directed him for about a year to go to all these places and do all these things. But Ray is a guy who's never trusted anyone in his whole life. He barely even trusts his own brothers. He's a canny, stir-wise, career criminal. Mm-hmm. And yet, here he is supposedly trusting this guy named Raul, who he doesn't know his last name. He doesn't know his ethnicity. He doesn't know where he lives. He doesn't have a phone number. He doesn't have anything on this guy, Raul. But he's like, yes, master, I will go to Birmingham and buy a gun. You know, I will go to Los Angeles. He basically, it's almost like the Manchurian Candidate kind of idea, where Raul is so powerful and so convincing and so mysterious and exotic that Ray will just do anything he tells him to. Well, I believe that there was a Raul. It was in his own mind. It was basically Ray's imaginary friend. Or perhaps that Ray actually had some kind of, to a certain extent, a multiple personality disorder. I mean, this was just another alias, another character in Ray's a series of characters. I mean, you know, he was Paul Bridgman, he was Ramon Snead, he was Eric Galt, he was John Willard, he was Harvey Lohmeyer, he was also Raul. There was no actual Raul. It was, you know, it's just a very mysterious sounding name that he pulled out of the ether somewhere. Hmm.
Well, Hampton, it's a fascinating read. It's called Hellhound on His Trail, The Stalking of Martin Luther King Jr. and the International Hunt for His Assassin. Thank you for joining.
Great to be here.